new technology has risks associated with it. We all benefit from new pharmacy drugs, from new materials, from new agricultural products, modern electronics, all of which enrich our lives. All of these technologies carry risks. The challenge is not to eliminate the risks, but to make choices that minimize the risk while maintaining the quality of life that we all have come accustomed to. Electrical energy is one of those technologies that's essential for the economy of developed nations. A modern economy depends upon ubiquitous, reliable, and relatively inexpensive electrical power. And it's the task of the public and private decision makers to provide this goal of abundant, reliable, and affordable electrical energy at the least risk to the health of individuals and damage to the environment. What I want to do in my 20 minutes is focus on the national level, the national perspective, and I will defer comments about San Onofre to others. I want to focus on electrical energy, not total energy. So let me remind you a little bit about the history of nuclear energy. Commercial nuclear energy began approximately 50 years ago, has produced about 15,000 reactor years of performance. There are approximately 430 reactors producing electricity in the world today, and a little over 100 of those are in the United States. There's approximately another 100, approximately another 66 reactors under construction around the world, primarily in China, South Korea, and Russia. The role of nuclear power in generating electrical energy is shown in this slide. Coal generates is the source of fuel for about 42% of the electrical energy consumed in the country. Natural gas, about 25%, meaning fossil fuels contribute almost 70% of the electrical energy used by this country. Nuclear provides approximately 20% of the electrical power, and renewables about 13%. If you look at the list of renewables, hydro is the most prevalent, followed by wind. Down at the bottom today is solar. I would expect wind to increase dramatically over the next couple of decades. Solar will increase dramatically. Hydro is probably at its maximum capacity. We've dammed just about every river there is in this country. A stable and reliable electrical grid is essential to providing the electricity that we've all become accustomed to. And one of the issues with the electrical grid is the distinction between base loading and peak loading. During the afternoon, we consume more electricity for our air conditioning than we do at night. However, during the full course of the day, there's a certain base load that has to be maintained. I believe a subsequent speaker will talk about the need for base load to maintain the stability and reliability of the electrical grid. Over time, technology called the smart grid will enable greater uses of intermittent power. And for the time being, some substantial fraction of the electricity has to be provided by base loading. Base loading in this country is primarily provided by fossil fuels and nuclear. One other measure of reliability when considering our stability of our electrical grid is something called the factor capacity. What fraction of the total generating capacity of a power plant is actually delivered? On a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week basis across the United States, nuclear power delivers about 90% of the maximum capacity it can. The other 10% is downtime, repair time, and so on. The intermittent energies typically have a load capacity of around 25 to 33%. The sun doesn't shine all the time, the wind doesn't blow all the time. Coal and nuclear are basically online all the time. So we need stable, reliable, base-loaded capacity, and where do we get it? Right now we get it from fossil fuels. Everybody knows that fossil fuels are potentially extraordinarily damaging to the environment. Global climate change, all the studies suggest that over the next few decades, the increase in temperature, the increased variability of the weather will be significant, and all of us will feel the effect of CO2 emissions. This particular graph looks at CO2 emissions per unit of electrical energy generated. It's in kilograms of CO2 per kilowatt hour of electrical energy. And you certainly can see the scale of the emissions. Coal is by far the worst. Natural gas is better by about a half. Nuclear has some CO2 emissions. This is a life cycle analysis. You have to make concrete to build nuclear plants. The manufacture of concrete involves fuels that will generate CO2. So I'm trying to do a life cycle analysis. If I looked at operating emissions, nuclear is essentially zero. But that's not fair. You really have to do a life cycle analysis. The same thing is true of renewables. You have to look at the life cycle CO2 emissions to get a reliable estimate of the impact on the global environment. Clearly, nuclear and renewables are far superior to any fossil fuels. I think any rational energy policy has to result in the emission of CO2, less dependence on fossil fuels in the world. I personally believe that the reduction of global greenhouse gases is among the greatest challenges of the 21st century. Nuclear energy and renewable energy are the obvious options for achieving this purpose. The problem is that renewables are intermittent, and you have to deal with the base loading requirements of the grid to provide ubiquitous, reliable electrical energy. Of course, what the issue here is how safe it is. So one obvious way to measure safety is to look at mortality rate, the number of deaths per kilowatt hour of generated capacity. So here's a graph, again, looking at life cycle analyses, the number of deaths per kilowatt hour of generated capacity. This includes actual and epidemiologically projected deaths. Coal is the most dangerous form of fuel we have for making electricity. It's the fine particulates that go up the stacks. It's the result of the ash that's stored. If you do a comprehensive epidemiological study, you can see the number of deaths. They're about 15 deaths per kilowatt hour. Natural gas is better. It doesn't have the same level of fine particulates that coal does. On nuclear, I've included Chernobyl and Fukushima to give you a sense of the number of global deaths per kilowatt hour. And renewables are the safest form of energy available. But again, if the task is to reduce our dependence on fossil fuels, the cleanest and safest technologies are nuclear and renewable. I've included Fukushima and Chernobyl in these analysis. Those are the two events along with Three Mile Island that gets everybody's attention. So let me just comment a little bit about each of those accidents. Chernobyl is a unique reactor design. The acronym in Russian, I don't know any Russian, but the acronym in Russian is RBWK design. It uses graphite rather than water as a moderator, which means it is inherently unstable in a loss of coolant situation. So for example, it suffers from what's called a positive void coefficient, that under certain operating conditions, if bubbles are formed in the coolant, that is, if it boils, if it turns to steam, then the reactor increases its reactivity, hence potentially a runaway situation. All the reactors in the Western world, Japan, Europe, and the United States, use water as the moderator, would not suffer from this criticality incident that destroyed Chernobyl. There was also no containment vessel at Chernobyl. The reason the Russians were interested in lowering costs, building reactors quickly, and for the ease of plutonium production. The reactor at Chernobyl was, among other purposes, used to produce weapons-grade materials. And in order to enhance the production of weapons-grade material, it was convenient not to have a containment vessel. all the reactors in the United States, Europe, and Japan are incapable of producing weapons-grade material. The operators at Chernobyl blatantly disregarded operating procedures in order to conduct the test. And if you read the history of Chernobyl, you wonder, what in the world were those operators thinking? They blatantly disregarded normal operating procedures. Nevertheless, the number of immediate deaths from the radiation is estimated on the order of 30 to 40 people who died as the result of acute radiation syndrome. It's not the immediate effects of radiation that are the concern from a public health perspective, but the lingering effects. The estimated total fatalities is at least several thousand, perhaps tens of thousands, if you look over a 50-year period following the reaction, and you look at the total population of perhaps 5 million people that were exposed. My personal opinion is that Chernobyl is not a precedent-setting event for reactors in the United States, Europe, or Japan. The technologies are significantly different. The regulatory processes are significantly different. I think Chernobyl is a unique, singular event. On the other hand, Three Mile Island and Fukushima are more indicative of what the risks are for modern nuclear power plants. Three Mile Island in 1979 suffered a severe core meltdown. It was a consequence of faulty pressure valve, a pressure valve that didn't close when it should have, and instrumentation that provided the operators with incomplete and inaccurate information. There was a substantial period of days when there was reasonable confusion among the operators as to what the cause was. They made a number of decisions which did lead to a severe core meltdown. Nevertheless, the containment vessel functioned as it was designed. No significant release of radiation. No immediate or projected fatalities. There was, however, a significant economic loss. Unit 2 was permanently shut down, and in today's dollars, that would represent an economic loss of billions of dollars. Fukushima is the most serious accident in the history of commercial nuclear energy, and I exclude Chernobyl for the reasons I mentioned earlier. Three operating reactors at Fukushima automatically shut down upon the earthquake with no immediate damage. The reactors responded to the ground shake exactly as designed. However, the subsequent tsunami destroyed the backup power, and that led to a loss of coolant event, which resulted in a core meltdown. There was a significant release of radiation at Fukushima, about 10% of the radiation emitted at Chernobyl. Now, there are different kinds of radiation. Fukushima is primarily cesium, some xenon, and iodine. At Chernobyl, there were some heavy elements emitted from the fuel itself. So if you look at the total radiation, it's about 10% of Chernobyl. There were no immediate deaths at Fukushima due to radiation. There were two or three industrial accidents, people falling off scaffolds, for example. The projected deaths from radiation-induced cancers range from 15 to 1,500, depending upon the assumptions that you make over the next 50 years. The number will depend on how active the Japanese government is in decontaminating the environment. It will also depend upon the relocation policies that are put in place. The highest estimate there assumes no decontamination and everyone goes back home. So it's an upper limit. Nevertheless, 1,500 deaths is significant. The best estimates are perhaps 130. Now, that 130 deaths from the industrial accident has to be put into the context of the natural disaster that killed 15,000 or more people. Fukushima represents 1% or so of the human fatalities in that enormous tragedy, catastrophe in Fukushima. One reactor that's not mentioned is Okinawa. This is a nuclear installation that was closer to the epicenter than Fukushima. It was approximately 55 miles away, while Fukushima was about 100 miles away. There were three reactors at this installation generating about 2.2 gigawatts of energy. That's the same size as San Onofre. That reactor immediately shut down with no damage. All the safety systems functioned as expected. The seawall successfully withstood the tsunami. No release of radiation, no radiation exposure to any of the workers, and also no mention in the newspaper of this reactor. It worked. And if something works, you don't typically read about it in the newspapers. Let me conclude with just a few comments about radiation, since radiation is the primary concern. So just remind everybody, radiation is ubiquitous. We're exposed to it all the time. The normal background radiation here in Southern California is about 3 millirems per year. A millirem is a unit of damage to the human body. Medical treatment had, depending upon what kind of treatments you receive, perhaps another 0.6 millisieverts per year. Many individuals will receive medical treatments over a lifetime that will equal the normal background radiation. If you look at where the background comes from, it comes from radon, which is a radioactive gas that's in the air all around us. It comes from cosmic radiation, about 8% here at sea level. The rocks in the soil, the uranium in the soil, we have stone over here. There's radiation coming from this concrete. Consumer products produce a little bit of radiation. All of you have smoke detectors in your home. They all produce a little radiation. Quite negligible compared to background, but it's there. So we receive somewhere between 3 millisieverts and 6 millisieverts from natural background radiation and normal medical procedures. To give you a sense of what a sievert means, exposure over the long term, about 25 sieverts is lethal. Short-term dose is about 10. A short-term dose is more deadly than a long-term dose. The body does have some form of repair mechanisms. Over a long term, we can absorb greater radiation than on a short-term basis. The lifetime dose, if you live in Denver, which I'll comment about in a moment, is about half a sievert. Lifetime dose here in Southern California is about a quarter of a sievert. So if you live to be 80, you will have been exposed to a total radiation dose of about a quarter of a sievert. The maximum dose to any resident of Fukushima was 0.07. That was the maximum. And there was only a handful of people who received that level of exposure. A typical full body CT scan is about 0.02 sieverts, which means the worst case in Fukushima was on the order of 3 CT scans. The maximum exposure from Three Mile Island was a millisievert, and a round trip flight to Tokyo is about 20 microsieverts. Gives you some idea of radiation in the natural environment. Richard Mueller, a professor up at Berkeley, likes to talk about what he calls the Denver dose. Denver has a higher natural radiation background than Southern California. It's not the altitude, it's the rock. There's more radon present in the environment in Denver because of the granite. It's higher elevation, but that's not the primary reason. It's living next to granite that produces the extra radon. And if you live in Denver, you're exposed to about 6 millisieverts, or twice what you are in LA. Very few of us would use the additional radiation exposure in Denver if we were deciding to relocate. We willingly and automatically accept doubling the background radiation when we make our daily decisions. My brother chose to go to Denver, and he didn't think about radiation. He's a physicist also. The projected cancer deaths over 70 years at that higher radiation is about 5,000 deaths. Many times that of Fukushima for the population living in Denver. Now, also, the death rate from cancer in Denver is less than the United States average. Now, Now, I'm not saying that low levels of radiation convey a health aspect. I'm saying that other factors in the environment are far more important in determining cancer deaths than radiation. Japanese government is imposing on the residents of Fukushima standards that you and I would willingly accept to move to Denver. So let me stop here, since I've used up my time, and just conclude that nuclear energy is the cleanest and safest of the alternatives available for providing baseload electrical power. Safest for the world and safest for the public health, nuclear is far preferable to coal. Thank you.